We have perhaps got a slight pushback in the next SpaceX launch that we're anticipating, but let's just talk about these lunar rovers in particular. What does this mean for the space industry?
Sure. I mean, 2025 is going to be a massive year for the space economy, and you don't need any more proof than what's happened in the first couple of weeks, right? So yesterday, SpaceX launched 130 payloads, different satellites to orbit on a transporter mission. Our portfolio companies made up half of those satellites, so that was a lot of fun to watch. This morning, they launched two lunar rovers on the same rocket, one of which is a Japanese lander, and another is Firefly, based in Texas. And they're robotic precursor missions for NASA, in basically with sensors to do exploratory work in preparation for humans to go and land there. And there's another lunar mission that's launching next month. So while these landers are on their way to the moon, we're going to launch another one as well. And like you mentioned, it was supposed to happen today, but it looks like weather's pushed it till tomorrow. SpaceX's next-gen launch vehicle, massive, fully reusable launch vehicle, is going to bring the price of accessing orbit way down, is going to transform the space economy and really accelerate all this growth that we're seeing so far.
So Starship, we wait, we watch. We also anticipate 1 a.m. today, New York time, where the Blue Origin, which competes against Falcon 9, maybe a bit bigger in terms of payloads, is actually going to get up with its test flight.
Yeah.
What does that mean, this sort of introduction of yet more competitors to the space?
Well, this is really important because at the moment, SpaceX dominates, right? I mean,
good for you.
Yeah, I mean, it's great for a lot of people who are invested in the company. They are launching the majority of rockets. I mean, 2024 was a record year. SpaceX launched over half of the global launches last year. They launched over 90% of all the mass that went to orbit went through SpaceX, right? They are the best option on the market. And in some cases, the only option on the market. So to have other players and other competition is going to be huge. We've been looking at the interesting thing between SpaceX and Blue Origin is just, you know, you got Bezos and Musk, right, to send to billionaires. The companies were founded at the same time in 2002. Up until a couple years ago, they had invested the same amount of money into both companies. And you look at what SpaceX has done over that period, right, just really dominated the market, enabled all of this entrepreneurship, innovation, and private capital. Meanwhile, Jeff Bezos has been launching these sort of luxury trips to the edge of space with these small rockets. New Glenn is their vehicle that is going to launch satellites and enable them to do all those things like lunar missions and everything else that Blue Origin wants to do. So it's really important that they get this vehicle up, and it's really important for the rest of us because competition is good. It ushers in innovation and brings prices down for everyone.
Chad, what do you see the incoming Trump administration doing to help foster the space industry from your standpoint? And what are some of the things you would like to see the new president do when he takes office?
Well, I mean, we certainly expect to see a greater emphasis, a greater promotion of the space economy, a greater integration of commercial capabilities into government programs. I think we've already seen in this transitionary period the geopolitical turmoil. I think a lot of that is going to spur additional growth in defense spending, a lot of which is going to go to space companies. There's going to be an increased reliance on the providers that have the capability. SpaceX, again, is chief amongst them. They're most likely to benefit here, not just because of his first buddy status, but also because they have the best solution on the market. And again, in some cases, the only solution on the market. So the government is going to rely even more heavily on Starshield and their government businesses, but others are going to benefit as well with more competition coming online, more novel, new capabilities. We do expect to see streamlining of regulation, you know, and pro-growth stances to really help some of these new and novel space capabilities come online this year.
Chad, let's talk about some of those regulations and some of the regulatory pressures that the industry has faced. What are some of the specific areas of relief that the industry would like to see?
Well, regulation plays a key role in a lot of space activities. Interestingly, though, the U.S. government has actually been very responsive to this. For example, I mean, there was an Australian company that launched a satellite that could look up and evaluate and see other satellites and what was going on there. You couldn't do that in the U.S. and many other countries, but there was a regulatory loophole in Australia that allowed them to do that. As soon as they launched that satellite, the U.S. government responded and enabled U.S. Companies to be competitive. And we're now seeing a lot of that data coming down. So we've already seen responsiveness from a regulatory front. I think an interesting angle here is that we expect to see a sort of about face on climate policy. And so I think climate solutions are going to be a key area for private capital, as they were during his last term, for companies to come in and provide innovative solutions funded by private capital.